So let's welcome our next guest to the stream. It's Mr. Brian Tong. Hey, how you
what
doing,
up,
man?
What up, Viking Doof?
How you baby? Doing? I'm good, man. How are you?
I'm good. I mean, I know there's a time zone difference and everything, but I literally like woke up like 15 minutes ago. And that's why my eyes look sleepy. No, you're not. It's good. I should be up. It's 9 a.m. out here. So it's all good, man. But thank you so much for having me. Thanks for inviting me to be a part of this. You know, we're all part of this community and just awesome to be here. So thanks, man.
Thank you for being here. I kind of wish I'd set my backdrop up better now because I've got my one here and my cube is like sat on the shelf over there and it's got like books on top of it right now.
I mean, why don't you just hold them on each hand this whole time?
I think so. They're pretty
if you do
light.
That, I'm totally okay with that. Just hold it on each hand and we're good.
And we've got a G4 IMAX Sunflower guy over here that we were playing with earlier in the stream as well.
Classic.
So, we've had a good time. But how are you?
Oh, you know, I mean, right now we know it's kind of like the lull of the season, right? You know, we're just kind of waiting for actual products to drop instead of talking about the same 10 rumors over and over and over in every different permutation.
Yes.
You know what I mean? And also, I quite honestly think, yeah, you know, we're all excited about like Apple stuff, but you know, the more as time has gone on with these foldables and people have their own take on foldables, right? Some people love them, some people don't. I tend to feel that most people that don't like them have never even actually tried using one for a week to understand how they're different. They just look at it like, why do I need something foldable? And it is really more of a peek in the future. But you know, this iPhone 13 that's coming up, I think that it feels like to me how I felt when I had the 10 and I didn't upgrade the 10s. And I'm like, what's so great about the 11 Pro? And all of a sudden what happened is arguably for me, the 11 Pro is one of my favorite iPhones because of its battery life and its camera. And at the time, everyone's like, 11 Pro. And I was one of those people, right?
Yeah.
The 11 Pro surprised me. And I don't know if it's going to happen this way or play out this way. And it depends on where you are in your upgrade cycle. But I've been pretty I haven't been all bullish on, yes, iPhone 13. But now with all these kind of new camera leaks that recently came out and the idea that, okay, it'll have a better battery, the processor will probably be even better at optimizing the power use. It might be kind of like an 11 Pro type year that sneaks up on some people. So that's where my brain is at.
Yeah.
That's what actually happens. But I've not really been too hot on the iPhone 13 this entire year.
No, I've got to agree. Like everyone, I think for ages was saying, oh no, it's a small upgrade. You know, it's a little tweaks. It's this, it's that. But then all of a sudden everyone's like, no, you know what? This is actually huge. Especially like it's the portrait mode video. That's the one that for me, or cinematic video, I think they might be calling it.
Let's guess what are they going to call it?
The marketing name is the important part.
Yes. So okay, I know we're putting each other on the spot. I want to think, what do you think it's going to be like their marketing name?
So now I thought portrait mode video, and I was talking about this last year when they put LiDAR on the iPhone 12 Pro Max and the 12 Pro. I was like, this is what's happening. This is why they're putting it in there, because you get a depth map. I think it's a processing issue. I don't think they had enough power to do it in real time in the viewer the way that they
At the quality that they want. That is up to their standard.
Exactly. but I think cinematic video might be what they call it.
Okay. I'm going to go out on a limb here, right?
Mm-hmm.
Portrait video.
Like they mentioned for FaceTime at WWDC.
Portrait video. I think it's going to blow. I think it's going to blow our mind away.
I think it is going to blow our minds away when we see it and they have the horses running across the savannah at the event in September.
But, oh yeah. Okay. I have a quick question. How do you think I'm just trying this out for fun. How do you think the audio is on this right now on this machine that I'm using? Does it sound decent? I know it's not, I didn't have time to like grab my mic. Does it sound pretty decent?
It's not bad at all. I mean, it's maybe a little bit bassier.
Interesting. I'm using the M1 iMac mic right now. I just wanted to try it.
Not bad at all.
Because
definitely serviceable for a call. But guys, down in the chat, let us know what you think of it in terms of Linda Lawson has already put nope in just big letters. But Linda is all about streaming. Linda is all over this stuff. And she was the one telling me how great this camera is, and it's not as bright as I would like. And I've got the ISO all the way up, but you know,
You look
So guys,
beautiful. You look
let us
beautiful.
know down in the chat there. We've got Ian Zeblo, by the way, in the chat right now.
Oh yeah, my boy, Ian. Come on now.
Yeah. So
Good
we've
man.
got a whole bunch of chat going on. We have been going now for 4 hours and 5 minutes. It's quite the stream. We had a little bit of an issue with the. We're running this all, by the way, on a base M1 Mac Mini.
That's how we do it. Man, that machine is incredible. The value on that machine is ridiculous. I think that even not only when it launched, but let's talk about a year or two from now, it's still going to be whether or not they keep it in the like that. Let's say they
As
in a
it is.
year, right, they take like $100 off of it even, right? Incredible. Incredible machine. That was the machine that tempted me. I was really I honestly this M1 iMac is I'm actually sending it back. It was a review unit that I was fortunate enough to get, but I was on. I don't own a per personally. I don't own an M1 machine that I've used. That's why I've been just waiting for the new MacBook Pro so bad. I've been like pining for that thing. So it's like cracked to me, right? But you know that M1 Mac Mini. That was the one that I was like, should I do it? I'm like, just wait it out. Just wait it out. You know, I'm not gonna be buying every single thing that they put out. Let's be
No.
honest. You know,
No.
I'm gonna be a
There's
realistic consumer.
so much right now, and to be completely honest, I've been blown away with the Mac Mini. My wife is using an M1 MacBook Air, so she picked that up.
Oh.
The base model, we got that on launch day for her. We were literally, I said to her, "You are not buying one until the Intel stuff comes out." She needed it for her college
Yeah,
stuff,
yeah.
and I was like, "You're not buying an Intel one. It's not happening until
Yo,
the
man,
M1 has come out."
I think they should call you M1 Cave Dave now. I mean, if you got M1 and your wifey does, come on now.
We
Let's
got a couple going on right here, but yeah, I'm definitely I'm hoping for the M1X Mac Mini as well. I know we've seen some renders for it from John, who's on the show later, and in fact done by Ian, I think, who's in the chat. So we've got some good stuff going on. We've actually got a super chat here that I think we should probably hit up,
Super chat.
which is Evan Rogers asking what are you looking forward to most from Apple in the next 1 to 2 years.
Is he asking us both? I know what I'm looking most forward to in 1 to 2 years. Actually,
Is
one to two.
it
Yeah, I mean,
a
that's not 1 to 2 years. That's 1 month. That's
Yeah,
1 month.
but it's within that.
Yeah, it's that is true. But if I had to say looking forward, I would say most anticipated device in 1 to 2 years would be the Apple Watch. I think that. The health sensor potential that we still haven't seen untapped yet. I can't even, it's so, you know, there's so many things. I can't remember the name off the top of my head, but they're working with this sensor company that had just released like a new systems on a chip package that
It does everything.
basically, what was it? Yeah,
Does
everything.
everything, doesn't it?
Blood alcohol, blood glucose, blood
Body
oxygen,
temperature.
blood pressure. And
Yeah.
it's still in testing right now, but Apple, this is the same company that has developed the sensors that we currently have right now for blood oxygen. When we get to that point where, and you know, it doesn't have to be as accurate as walking into a medical facility, much like we saw with the heart rate stuff before. It has to be, you know, like pretty much dang good, but not on like a professional walk-in, like hook me up to a machine sensor. But you know, we start talking about those type of things on a watch that are non-invasive, and it might even be longer than 1 or 2 years based on testing. And we
Yeah.
know even a place like I think Australia got ECG like two
Last month.
years later, right? So we don't know how long that's going to take, but you start putting all those sensors on the most popular smartwatch that still has yet to be untapped and unlocked for someone who's not an Apple user. Whoo, that's I think there's a whole lot of potential. I mean, I love using the Apple Watch because I literally try to disconnect as much as I can now because we're, you know, being an independent creator like yourself, been doing it now for 3 years. I mean, I don't want to, there's times where I really just don't want to be connected, you know? And so there's so much value in that. And for just diabetes alone, if they can get that blood glucose, that's going to be incredible. So
Absolutely.
if it all lines up, that's what I'm probably most excited to see.
And like my eldest son has diabetes. He's got type 1, so he wears one of the sensors on the back of his arm, but that has to be inserted. It uses a small needle to insert it. If I, now I don't believe that they will be accurate enough that you can do your insulin from them. But I do think that it's going to stop a lot of people being admitted for the first time with a diabetic issue as an emergency, because people will be able to see their trends over time of the fact that this blood glucose level is rising, because that's something that people just aren't able to check themselves in general without equipment. And if your Apple Watch is just like, hey, you might want to just go and check, get checked out because your glucose levels are changing over time, that's gonna save a lot of people a lot of issues. So I think that's really interesting. We've got a few suggestions. So we've got portrait video. That's a very good suggestion. That's coming from.
Right, hey, while you go down this list, I'm retweeting your tweet so people know that we're kicking it. I'm sorry.
Amazing. So we've got Renders by Ian is saying portrait video. That's a solid guess. Apple Pro video. Now we think that's ProRes as well, right? That's not a bad
James shout, Apple, though. Not bad at all. Not bad at all. That might be it. That might be it.
Audio sounds good according to Surroundbyte, so that's pretty good. Audio is awesome from Tech Hyped. Sounds amazing. A1 Brian Tong on the audio. So this is feedback for your M1 iMac.
I thought James Apple was talking about like A1 steak sauce. I mean, if we want to go, let's go. Let's get a steak in the morning. We know steak and eggs. I mean, that's a thing. I've never done that.
We don't get A1 steak sauce over here. That's not a thing we get. We get daddy's sauce over here.
I mean, I'm not the biggest fan of A1 steak sauce. I just like keep the meat. Like, hey, give me some
of the idea of steak.
Yeah, give me some time. Keep it clean. Have you ever sous vide before? Have you ever done sous vide?
Oh, yes. Yeah, so we have a few people that are saying really hyped for Apple Glass. So Surroundbyte, Half Man, Half Tech, all coming back to this for the next 1 to 2 years. Do we think it's going to be that quick? Do we think by 2023 we might have something?
Maybe. You know, I think that the difference that people, I think what people are expecting and what's going to come out is going to be a lot different. So, for example, you know, we all dreaming of this idea of Apple Glass looking like the frame glasses that we have today.
Yeah.
Whatever they put out for that first generation is not going to look like that. It's just not. Just from a standpoint of where the industry is in general, you know, are they going to maybe put out like a VR Air headset? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. You know, this is not a plug. It just so happens with good timing. I recently did an interview with the head of Qualcomm's VR AR division. I'm putting up a video this week. And I directly asked him, like, where are we, you know, from a standpoint of form factors? And the idea that everyone is lusting after the true glasses, we're talking about 3 to 5 years, if not maybe a little more. So I just want to set people's expectations that this is probably going to be more like a VR AR headset that you're used to seeing.
Yeah.
And don't get I'm not trying to crush people's dreams, but let's not get ahead of ourselves and be like, we're going to get the frame glass. Like, I don't even wear glasses, but I would try those glasses.
Whatever. Yeah. Yeah.
You know,
no, I think it's going to be awesome. Like, having seen what the Microsoft HoloLens actually can do, if you can bring that down to a size that doesn't look like you're about to go into battle in Starship Troopers, that's going to be pretty compelling.
Yeah.
Like, they even used it as like, do you get the Resident, the TV show over there? I'm sure they
I'm not watching that. If it is here in the US.
Yeah. The Resident, it's like a medical drama. They kind of featured HoloLens in one of them where the surgeons were all using it. And apparently it was actually pretty accurate to what it's like to use the HoloLens. And I was like, if that's true, this thing is insane. I've never played with something like that, but I'm that hyped me up for Apple Glass and stuff.
Like, you know, it's like anything, it's the combination of the hardware and the software. So quite honestly, the hardware is actually there, but it's just not the size we want. And this is just going to take time. This is technology in general. I mean, we're freaking spoiled the fact that a freaking HoloLens exists. Let's be real. Like, I got to try those out at Microsoft Developer Conference, I think the first year it launched. And even what they were showing us developer tools of how it could scan an environment and create a wireframe of literally everything, like a three-dimensional wireframe just by putting it on. We like threw a ball and watched it bounce and it, you know, a virtual ball.
And it was tracking it.
Yeah, and it was bouncing on everything from this table surface to, you know, the floor to the wall. And I'm just like, damn, this is crazy. But as we've seen, it's not like that has taken off in a consumer space.
No.
Right? So it just takes a lot of time. And we got all the time. You know, we're waiting to see that. But it'll be interesting. I mean, I'm intrigued by it. I feel like it's one of the spaces that, because Apple in general has, you know, whatever, however people perceive this, how they'll come out with, you know, like 120 hertz refresh rate, like 3 or 4 years after the competition. Mm-hmm. I think the glass space is a space where people might feel, this is perception again, that Apple is innovating once again. You know, I think every company is innovating in different ways.
Yeah.
And sometimes that innovation works, sometimes it doesn't. And Apple tends to not take as many risks when it comes out. They don't need to, because they've got the ecosystem and all of us watching and hanging out who are like, oh, I'll get the iPhone 13, even though there's all this other crazy stuff on other platforms, but the ecosystem matters. So, and they've been really smart about that. Like, kudos to them for establishing that. That's a competitive advantage.
Absolutely. And I think a big chunk of it as well is that Apple has all of the features in one device. Whereas when you look at the Android side, there's like one device that's great for screen tech and one device that's great for hiding the camera really well. And another device that's really, and like for battery life or for gaming or for whatever else. But Apple just kind of brings together all the right bits at the right time, I think, and makes it more of a compelling kind of overall experience. And especially when you then pair it with a Mac and an Apple Watch and an iPad. And when we get universal control finally working in the betas, that will be incredible. But like,
oh, so you're all hyped up for universal control.
Yeah. Why announce that and then not let us play with it? I want to play with it now.
Put it in the beta. Yeah. Put it in the beta.
Come on.
That's what a beta's for.
I don't mind if it doesn't work perfectly to begin with. That's okay. Just let me play with it.
Oh yeah, for sure.
But yeah, I mean, what's your, I know your biggest hype is obviously for the MacBook Pros right now, but like looking forward, in terms of like the MacBook Air with M2 that we're hearing about coming maybe next year, like what do you think Apple's biggest play is going to be? Because I think M1 should be going into a smaller Mac Mini that's like Apple TV size almost, that you can just throw on any TV and use your phone as your controller. But is there anything that you think Apple should be pushing towards that they've not touched onto yet?
Well, I think, you know, I think what they are pushing on, and really it's already changed the game. I hate using that, but then this is more than appropriate. It's their Apple Silicon, you know. Yeah. Their M1 has proven, like when the M1 first came out, most people, I guess, are we going to say pundits, tech YouTubers, even people that are like the most ardent Apple fans, did not believe what Apple was saying with the M1. You had to experience it. You had to, you know, physically use an M1 device and see how quiet it was, how much from a laptop standpoint, the battery performance, and then just the freaking raw performance. And then people are like, holy, right?
Yeah.
So that, to me, that is at the, you know, when has there been this much excitement around a Mac product? I mean, right? This is a new era. They're now, you know, looking to seriously compete / potentially surpass what we're seeing from a company. Like, we'll see what they do with their Mac Pro product and with an M2 or even just an M1X. But for people that are automatically thinking like, let's jump to the M2, sure, that's exciting. But I think there's a lot more legroom that can be done and squeezed out. And just from a pure standpoint of packing in more cores in the M1 architecture with what we saw on their very first offering. This is their first offering ever. That's probably the most exciting thing for me of, and how that, to your point, trickles down. Now,
absolutely.
The M1 in the iPad did nothing different.
Yeah.
I'm actually pretty sad. I typically avoid the, I don't know why I do it, but I typically haven't done 6-month reviews of products after, right? Like the long-term review. But, you know, I kept my 2018 iPad Pro. I bought the M1 iPad Pro, and maybe it was my fault for not only being an iPad Pro fan, but expecting kind of big things with all of the hardware that they packed into it. But I use my iPad Pro exactly the same, like other than the screen really being, having better black levels. And I know people are going to complain about the blue. It's still a better screen than the previous screen, hands down. But I would say if I had to do it all over again, I would not have kept the M1 iPad Pro right now.
Yeah.
And I felt that way, but I just wanted to try it out because it was so new and maybe Apple's going to give us something from a software standpoint that really changed it up. They didn't.
So my, My theory on this one, and we'll come to the question that I've just popped up on the screen now. I just didn't want to lose it because I think it's a really interesting one. But because we've just had the EEC filings for the new products coming out, so we've got iPhones, we've got Apple Watch, and we've got two MacBooks. Mm-hmm. There's no iPads in there at the moment. So I think that Apple is going to put out the MacBooks with the iPhones and the Apple Watches in September, and then we're going to get an iPad-focused event in October.
You think so?
I think that's what that's going to happen. Because
I like this because we all don't know now, so I like it.
So we haven't had anything filed for those yet, so I think they're going to put those out. Probably we'll get the filings for those just before we get the event announcement for September.
Maybe.
And then I think we get an iPad-focused event, we get our Mini, we get our new Air, both with A15, we get our Generation 9, and I think we actually get our Pro Apps, because I don't think the Pro Apps would have come at WWDC, because they'll need iOS 15. And they never mention that stuff at that point. So I think we maybe get the Pro Apps for iPad at that point. And then M1 makes sense all of a sudden, now that people have had it for 6 months.
Let me take your awesome theory and add my own theory on it. Okay. No, not destroy it. No, this is all fine. So I do think that I personally think there's no way we're going to see a MacBook Pro and iPhone launch on the same day, just because it's like too much goodness, right? Mm-hmm. But to piggyback on your thinking at the other event, if we see what you're saying, and which I like, I think it would be MacBook Pro, and then they say, oh, and these apps that we've shown you on this new MacBook Pro runs on your iPad Pro.
Mm-hmm.
So I could see that too. Again, you know, none of us are right, because none of us really know. We're just having fun here.
Of course. Yeah, absolutely.
You know, and so that I could see that. I just don't. It would be pretty, I mean, first of all, as a reviewer, I don't want to see them release the iPhone and the MacBook Pro at the same time, because they're already going to probably throw in Apple Watch and AirPods. Maybe AirPods. And I'm just going to be like, all right, well, say goodbye to my life for the next month and a half.
Absolutely. You know? Well, that's going to happen anyway. That's what the fall's for. but honestly, the reason that I think they might do it is because the Mac sells so much less volume, obviously, than iPhones. And it's the one event of the year they know they will get the most eyeballs on the MacBooks that are just going to obliterate basically anything else on the market, which is what M1 did, but they didn't know that at the time.
True.
Apple knew how performant it was going to be, but they didn't know what the support was going to be with the developers.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't know what the support was going to be like with everything else. So that's why I think... If they've got the real confidence in it, it's never going to overshadow the iPhone, but it might be just a great way to get that many more eyeballs on it for people to be like, oh my God, how is that outperforming like a 2070 in a MacBook Pro? You know?
I think that's a great... I think these are all great points from both of us. I'm going to actually give us both pats on the backs.
Okay.
Here, your back. Pat, give yourself a pat on the back. Thank you.
Good stuff. So let's get to Sanchit's question quickly, because he was one of the guests earlier on the show. He's got a great YouTube channel as well. Brian Tong, iCave Dave, do you think the Mac Pro will be cube-shaped? Because I know you're a cube fan, and not tower-shaped like we have right now.
I think I think the answer is both, right?
All of the above.
The answer is both from a mm-hmm. standpoint of, you know, whether based on reports that we've heard, but it makes sense. Like, I just don't see Apple all of a sudden, even though they are going to eventually move to all M1 chips. You know, the recent Mac Pro, the new design came out, what, a year ago? You're going to just, like, abandon that design and just scrap it after a year? No, I don't think so. I think there's a lot of people who invested in that platform. It's not costing Apple more to make that body. Like, they don't have to redesign it. There is still certain apps and purposes that machine serves, from a pure expandability, expansion, compatibility with mm-hmm. Different PCI type cards. So it will eventually maybe, you know, slowly trickle and maybe phase out eventually, but you've got to keep that Intel based tower still in the mix. And then the cube will be the M1 that is like a Mac Mini on steroids mm-hmm. and with a little more expansion. And that will serve, you know, that would actually serve a purpose for someone like me. But if you're like an audio engineer and you have all these input, like, you don't, you're not going to get the cube. You're just not.
Yeah.
And we know that, you know, you talk about MacBook Pros being a smaller percentage of the user base. I mean, a Mac Pro, man, I don't know the number, but it might be like 3% or 4% now of what they're.
I'd be surprised if it's that high.
I know. I was going to say 2, but I don't want to be like really.
I think it could be less than 1.
Really? Of their entire product?
In terms of volume.
Yeah.
Of Mac. But how's this? This is a complete like made up thing. What if? I like playing what if because Marvel's doing it right now. And
yo, let's go.
Marvel can do it. We can do it. What if they make an Afterburner style card that adds Apple Silicon to the existing Mac Pro?
Jesus, that's fun. That's gonna be expensive.
I think that would be like if that just runs your UI and all of the Apple Silicon native stuff, and then it can offload like heavy duty rendering to the Xeon CPUs that are still sitting there.
Mm-hmm.
Like it would be snappy as Apple Silicon and still have the kind of backup, and anything that's Intel will run natively on the Intel chips. Like, well, I don't know if they physically can, but it would be great if they can.
A, I think that's smart as hell. And B, I don't think Apple's going to do it. Because,
no, I don't think they're going to do it either.
Because, like, we know, like, they can't. That seems like too much of a PC mod in their company philosophy to embrace. But I 100% am behind that idea.
Would love it.
Right? Yeah.
And I know you and Tim are pretty close. I saw you guys at the new store opening with iJustine and everyone else. So I know you guys are pretty tight.
Yeah, man. You know, we gave them jabs. You know,
back into the Slack.
Yeah,
you and Tim have got set up. Just let him know that.
Hold up, actually, wait. Give me a second here. So Tim, what do you think about that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. No, he said no.
He said oh, okay.
No, he said stay tuned.
Okay. Yeah. That seems legit. Brian, thank you so much for taking the time to be on such a little channel. Because we are tiny. No,
we're a community. That's why look. You know, you got the passion. Like, this is part of, I think we all as tech YouTuber community should and need to embrace each other. I think it's all part of like all boats rise with the tide.
Yeah.
And I love it. And, you know, I wouldn't be a part of this if I didn't see your work and be like, you are an active member contributing to this community in an amazing way. So, you know, much love to you and, you know, continue to do that. And I don't care. Hey, size doesn't matter.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Is this Sunday morning? Holy cow.
I think now we have to end the show for this segment. Thank you so much. We've got a few other guys coming up. We've got Mark Sequence up next. We've got James sitting also in the queue waiting. And then we get on to some of the big hitters like yourself. So we've got John Prosser and we've got Luke coming on, Luke Miani. So it's going to be a pretty awesome kind of last hour to the show. Last 90 minutes we've got left going.
Congrats on this, iCave Dave.
It's a long time, man.
I'm going to tell you, I'll really be curious. I'm going to tune in. What time are you wrapping up at? That's what
so
I
it's
going to
be in 90 minutes from now, basically. So it's 6 p.m. GMT.
Okay, we'll see how delirious you are by then. You know, we'll see if your voice is still there.
Yeah.
If you've had to take a bathroom break, or you have a water bottle under there?
I haven't taken a bathroom break yet. I've got a lot of water bottles. Most of them are now empty. So it is going to be a challenge for that last 90, which is good. And if Tim gets back to you, feel free to jump back on and let us know what he says.
Hold on. Still stay tuned.
Okay. He's probably at the gym already, ready for tomorrow.
gym town laundry.
Yeah.
All right, bro.
Brian, thank you so much, man.
All right. See you. Peace, baby.
See you soon.